Michael, Don, and Peter here. How you doing?
Same to you guys. I'm doing great.
Now, you heard, if you were listening on hold, what Randy Levine said yesterday. Right now, even without making moves, which we will make, we're as good as the Red Sox. Do you feel that way?
Well, I certainly feel like we're as good as anyone and capable of beating anyone. You know, they're the world champions right now, so there's no denying what they ran off and did this season and then on in the postseason. So we're trying to get to that level, and we want to do what they were able to do this year. We feel like we have the people capable of competing with anyone in the world, including the Red Sox. And, you know, in a couple of months, we get to embark on that opportunity again.
Are these nerve-wracking times for you, Aaron? Because I know Yankee fans, you know, they're constantly checking social media to see what's happening, all the rumors, things like that. You're in the inside, so you kind of know which direction you guys are going, but you don't know if they're going to be able to pull everything that they want to pull off. So are you nervous all the time and constantly checking the phone, waiting for a phone call from Brian Cashman?
I don't know if I'd say nerve-wracking. I mean, exciting times. You know, I'm down at the ballpark pretty much most days. So I'm here and around and, you know, involved as much as I can be and paying attention. And, you know, so I would call them exciting times. It's fun being kind of on the outskirts and watching as, you know, our front office kind of plods a course to try and help us get a little bit better this offseason.
Now, the one big difference is the loss of Didi for however long, half the season, maybe all of the season. There's obviously options outside the organization, Aaron, but if you stayed within the organization, how would you handle it?
Well, I'm a little more optimistic on Didi's outlook than you just presented, but certainly it's a huge loss for us. I mean, it's hard to, you know, what Didi means to us offensively, defensively, just who he is, his presence is a huge loss. You know, internally, obviously we have Gleyber Torres who had a great first season, who played shortstop really his entire minor league career. So we feel like he gives us the flexibility in whatever way we go. So if we were to bring in, you know, somebody that may be a second baseman or a shortstop, we can kind of move and plug Gleyber accordingly. He kind of gives us that flexibility to keep a wide range of options open for us. You know, obviously Miguel Andujar coming back, having basically a rookie of the year campaign. So with those two guys that we feel like are going to be in our lineup for a long time, we feel like we're in a good place. Now it's just a matter of, you know, how big we go as far as trying to fill another area.
Now, you made a real big acquisition in Paxton. We haven't spoken to you since then. And a lot of people thought that Corbin would be the last piece of the pitching puzzle. Were you a little surprised that it worked out the way it did, where he ends up signing with the Nationals?
No, I wouldn't say I was surprised. I certainly knew we were obviously very interested. We, you know, had Patrick and his wife in last week and got to go to dinner and spend some time with them. You know, we knew there were other teams, obviously, that were going to be very involved. And obviously, in the end, the Nationals really stepped up, you know, with a big commitment. But no, I don't necessarily think I went into it surprised. I knew we liked the player and had hopes of bringing him here. But we also feel like there's other ways we can go to really improve our club and confident that we'll continue to work hard at that and get something done over the course of this winter.
And if it ends up being the rotation that you have now, would you think that would be enough?
Absolutely. I feel like we're trying to improve now on the margins. We know we have the players capable of winning the ultimate prize, and we can do that now. Now, it's a little more difficult, obviously. We need different players to emerge, to step up, for things to happen. But absolutely, we have the nucleus already in place to be an elite team again.
Now, we've had on the owner of the team, we've had on the GM, and we've asked him the same question, so I'll ask you, Aaron. You know, one of the players that's out there is Manny Machado, who did not run hard during the postseason, said he's not Johnny Hustle. things like that. Robinson Cano used to play for the Yankees, didn't run hard to first base all the time. We had A-Rod on yesterday. He said, you know what? He showed up at 7 o'clock every day in spring training, wanted to win. So we look at it a little bit differently. How do you look at a player that doesn't bust it to first base every single time?
Yeah, I mean, you hope players, you know, all the time run things out or play hard or give it their all. But it's not necessarily the number one thing that I look at when I'm defining whether a player is giving his all or is a gamer or is, you know, posting and being a guy that grinds when it's difficult behind the scenes. I think is a lot more indicative of who a guy is and kind of how he plays. You know, that said, you know, there is an expectation that we have, and hopefully as a professional that you have, that there's a certain, you know, way you go about things, and running balls out certainly can play into that. But it's frankly a little bit down the list as far as things that I define of what makes a player, you know, my definition of a guy that plays hard, that plays through adversity, that's tough, that really brings things behind the scenes, that has the ability to post when it's not easy. Those are things that define playing hard a little more to me.
But if you had a player that didn't hustle, how would you handle it?
Well, I mean, we have those things come up every now and then in the course of the year. We had a few of those instances that happened during the course of this season with some of our guys. And you address them in the way you think you need to you know, correct something or make sure things don't become repeated things or something that becomes you know, commonplace. Those are the things you want to eliminate.
Do you have to almost look at things differently, Aaron, than when you played? I mean, you come from a baseball family. Grandfather played, father played, brother played, you played. And I remember, you know, Joe Girardi, when he managed Cano, and I would ask him about not running hard to first base. He goes, you know what? If he doesn't run hard to first base a couple of times and I get 161 starts out of him, I'm okay with it. Do you have to look at it differently in 2018 and 2019 than you would maybe in 1980?
I don't know. Hopefully you look at things a little bit smarter. And frankly, there is a, you know, there is something to be said for, you know, I don't need my guy on a ground ball back to the pitcher where it's getting lobbed first. I don't need that guy sprinting, you know, through the bag every single time. Now, that said, there's a way to be a pro. There's a way to play this game hard and smartly at the same time. But over the course of 162 games, playing smartly is part of it. Now, I don't think running balls out falls under a category that's just allowed. Oh, he plays every day, so he doesn't have to run balls out. I don't buy into that. But there is a level of certain plays that happen on the course of the game where I think it is smart to play at a certain pace.
And so you do see a difference, though, between, for example, like you mentioned, a ground ball back to the pitcher and sort of a deep ground ball to shortstop or to third base. You see those differently.
Absolutely. And there's, yeah, I mean, and that's just – goes along with experience too of the game. There's certain times when you shouldn't put, I don't think you should ever put yourself in a position as a player to have a play happen and where a lack of hustle prevented you from being safe or what have you. And I think as a professional, as an experienced professional, you should know when that's inevitable.
Do you think going through the postseason, all the trials and tribulations of it, made you a better manager at the end of the day?
I hope so. I hope every single day, every experience, good and bad, successes and failures, hopefully you kind of take up stock of what went into that day and how you responded to different situations, and hopefully you're constantly learning from those experiences, good and bad. So I hope I sit here today better than I was yesterday and certainly at the end of the season.
All right, two quick questions. I know your time is limited. You've carved out time in your busy day. Number one, Jason Stark, your former colleague at ESPN, wrote a story for The Athletic that baseball might be considering getting rid of the shift. If you could push a button, and the Yankees are very active with the shift. They've got great analytics and take a lot of base hits away, but also a lot of hits are taken away from your hitters. Would you take away the shift the way we know it today?
Not necessarily. Now, if you presented a case well enough that it kind of made a lot of sense, then fine. But I'm more in the, you know, where I sit in this chair, I'm more in what are the rules now? How do we handle those? And like you said, I think we're one of the best in the sport at shifting, at putting our guys in position to create an advantage with it. So that's how I look at it right now under the current system.
And finally, break some news here, Aaron. Is there a big move coming for the Yankees, or is it going to be small moves? What can we expect? Is something going to happen?
I'm quite certain something will happen, and I think we're all looking forward to getting out to Vegas at the end of this week and start up the winter meetings. And you know, there's always going to be a lot of action, whether it's just a lot of talk at that point or it turns into smaller, large moves remain to be seen, but I'm sure there'll be some more moves coming your way.
Well, I'll be in Vegas, so I will see you there. So I look forward to seeing you.
Looking forward to you buying me a dinner there.
You got it. Absolutely.
Aaron, Merry Christmas to you and your family. Thank you for giving us this time today. We really appreciate it.
Thanks. Great talking to you guys.